Hi, and welcome to the Assemblines Podcast. I'm Chris Torrance. In today's episode, we're going to do a review of the A2 FPGA card now available from Reactive Micro. So let's get started. First of all, what is the A2 FPGA card? The FPGA gives you some indication. That stands for Field Programmable Gate Array. Field because you could program these out in the field. Programmable, obviously, because you could program it. And gate array, what that means is this chip on here is actually a series of logic gates that can be programmed and reprogrammed on the fly. So essentially, with a FPGA, you can take any regular computer chip or a series of chips and reproduce them by programming the gates that are on this chip, and you can do that over and over repeatedly. This has the advantage that it has the speed of a hardware device, so probably something like 10 to 100 times faster than doing something in software, but yet it has the flexibility because it can be reprogrammed. Now, there are some disadvantages. An FPGA is typically about 10 times slower than dedicated hardware, but this is a small price to pay if you need to either do a small run of boards or you want to be able to reprogram it on the fly. The A2N20 board was designed and created by Joshua Norid and Ed Anuff, and it's being distributed by Reactive Micro. As it currently ships out of the box, the board provides HDMI output as well as a Mockingboard clone. So essentially, it replaces the functionality of the VidHD card as well as a Mockingboard card. They've already added support for the Super Serial card, although they ran into some bugs, and so that's been temporarily disabled in the shipping firmware. The team also has plans to include support for possibly a Ethernet port as well as perhaps a mouse interface card. The real beauty of this card is that it can pretty much be programmed to replicate any of these cards as well as any other cards. One thing to note is that this is not an emulator. This is actually literally the hardware itself, just as if you had one of these cards in there. But it's just been programmed to handle all of the different signals and react as if it was one of these cards. The A2 FPGA will work on any Apple II, including the 2, 2 Plus, 2E, as well as the 2GS. On the 2, 2 Plus, and 2E, you can actually put the card in any slot on your computer. For the 2GS, it can only go in slot 3. One important point, if you want to use this as a Mockingboard, you can put it in any slot on your 2, 2 Plus, or 2E, but you can't have another card in slot 4 because it's emulating the Mockingboard as if it was in slot 4. You'll notice there's four dip switches on the card. The first switch here sets whether you want to have a scan line effect when you're doing the HDMI out. The second switch here sets whether you want the Apple II speaker sounds to come out through the HDMI or not. The third switch is a power on hold for 2 seconds. And this is needed because it takes approximately 2 seconds for the FPGA card to start up and begin working. And then finally, the last dip switch here, which is currently off, is if you're using this in a 2GS. Here I've got a Apple IIe enhanced with 128K of memory. I currently actually have a phaser card in slot 4, so I'm gonna go ahead and take that out because I won't need that with the Mockingboard support for the A2 FPGA. So we'll take that out. And I'm gonna go ahead and put in the A2 FPGA. If you'll notice on the card, it has a little note here for the keyboard end. Another way to remember it is that the HDMI should point towards the keyboard. Now, I already had the VidHD card in this machine, so I have a nice panel mount HDMI extension cable. Now, let's put it in slot 4, which is actually where the phaser card was, and I'll plug in the HDMI like that. And then we should be all set to go. The only other card I have in here, I have the soft SP card. So that gives me smart port support in case I want to run hard drive images. And then I have a regular disk 2 interface card with the W drive attached to that. Let's go ahead and start total replay. That's a good test of graphics as well as regular Apple II sounds. You can see it recognized there's a Mockingboard in slot 4, so that's good. You can also see the simulated scan lines here. In fact, actually, let's turn off the computer and I'll flip that dip switch number 1 and we'll see if the scan lines go away. So let's flip that off and I'll pop out the card here and I will flip switch number 1 to off, put it back into slot 4. Okay, and so now you can see all the graphics are just solid with no simulated scan lines. Let's go ahead and try a game which has some sound in it, just to see what that sounds like. So the Apple II speaker sounds should be coming through the HDMI cable because of the dip switch. And then I've got that routed to these speakers here. I've actually turned off the volume to my Apple II speaker, so we'll know whether it's working or not. All right, well, this seems to be working really well. The graphics look great, it's crisp. Everything seems to be functioning properly. I've put in the Mockingboard demo disc here, and we'll just boot that up. First, we'll try some sound effects. This is actually something that's pretty tricky to get right, so let's see how the A2 FPGA does with that. Okay. Okay. So that actually sounds really good. Let's try the laser. How about the bomb? We can actually try something with some Mockingboard sound, so let's try Skyfox. That seems to be working great and also sounds great. One other feature I forgot to mention is support for the Super Sprite card. This was a somewhat obscure graphics card that came out for the Apple II in the 80s, and it was designed to let the programmer create sprites on their Apple II and use those sprites to animate and for creating games. The problem is that with any of those graphics cards, there was kind of a chicken and egg thing where people never really made any games for the Super Sprite and therefore it never really sold that well, and of course then nobody made any games. I guess this is an example of the type of things you could do with this Super Sprite card. Clearly it's working. So the A2 FPGA is properly emulating the Super Sprite board. I'm not quite sure how many people are going to get use out of that. Okay, I'm not quite sure why the text is cut off like that. I don't know if that's the Super Sprite or the A2 FPGA that's doing that. The next thing I want to try is Nox Archaist. However, when Joe Strohsnyder tried this on his channel, he ran into some issues with the pulse width modulated sound at the beginning of Nox Archaist. I believe the simulated speaker output wasn't able to handle the PWM signal for Nox Archaist. The team has actually already issued a firmware update for that. So we're gonna go ahead now and we're gonna actually update the firmware on this A2 FPGA card. I'm currently on Reactive Micro's A2 FPGA page. Henry Corbis has put together an excellent description of the A2N20 board, and it has details on the card itself as well as some reviews. It has the dip switch settings, and then finally at the bottom, it has the latest firmware. So this was just updated yesterday. We'll go ahead and click on that. The zip file that I downloaded has a README PDF as well as the firmware file itself. The README goes through all the instructions for how to get the firmware and how to update it. So this talks about Mac and Linux, and then here's Windows. I happen to be on a Mac. The first thing we need to do is install this openfpgaloader, which will let us load the firmware onto the device. I've got a terminal open here, so I'll just do brew install openfpgaloader. Brew is a package manager for the Mac. If you don't already have that installed, you can just do a Google search for brew and you'll be able to find the download site as well as instructions. All right, it looks like the OpenFPGA loader is installed. The next thing we want to do is plug in our A2N20 board. So I'm using a USB-C cable here and just going from the board itself into my Mac. Okay, I want to go to the directory where I've saved the firmware file, and I type openfpgaloader-b for board, Tang Nano 20K. That's the FPGA board here. And then finally, I give it the firmware file itself, which ends in a .fs. And it says loading SRAM, and it's done. So that should be the latest version of the firmware. I think in the future, the A2 FPGA team is hoping to do some sort of on-screen menu for the Apple II. And if they do that, I hope they include the firmware version on it, because then it would be a great way to tell whether you're up to date or not. Nox Archaist. By the way, this is double high-res graphics here, so that's just proof that that works successfully. Let's see what the game itself looks like. All right, the graphics look fantastic. Okay, let's go into this town, and it should play some music. One thing I've noticed is that the sound from the Apple II speaker, which is coming through the HDMI, is considerably louder than the Mockingboard music. So you can see those clicks as I'm walking. That's just regular Apple II speaker sounds. And when I play the music, it's just a lot quieter. So it might be nice to have some way to change the volume of the output of the Apple II speaker relative to the Mockingboard sound, say, for example. I've now got the A2 FPGA card plugged into my Apple II Plus, and so we're gonna try this with a floppy disk. One interesting point, I used to use the VidHD card to get HDMI output, but the VidHD has a kind of terrible bug where if you try to boot with a floppy disk, it'll actually destroy it if it's not copy protected on boot. And this is just a known limitation of the VidHD. It doesn't happen all the time, but it happens often enough. So I'm hoping with the A2 FPGA that that isn't a problem. All right, so here we are in the Mockingboard demo again. Let's try the laser. I'm actually really excited. I've never actually had a Mockingboard in my Apple II Plus. This is the one I had as a kid, and I just never had a Mockingboard growing up. And also just to be able to get HDMI output out of this computer is pretty amazing. Full disclosure, Henry Corbis sends out cards for review. If you want to keep the card, then you pay for it. Otherwise, you can just send it back to him. Overall, I think this is a fantastic card. Out of the box, it's able to simulate an HDMI card such as the VidHD, as well as a fully featured Mockingboard card. I did notice with the Mockingboard sound that the volume was slightly less than the Apple II speaker, or maybe the other way around, the Apple II speaker was just a little bit too loud. It would be nice if there was some way to control the volume of those two relative to each other. The card itself is capable of doing a lot more. They already have support built in for the Super Serial card, but it sounds like there were some bugs that still needed to be worked out. And there's plans for perhaps adding support for the Ethernet card, as well as other cards. It was also able to replicate the Super Sprite card, which was a card that I'd never even heard of until this project came along. Yeah. The firmware update process was extremely simple, and that actually bodes really well for future upgrades. A lot of modern cards suffer from having either no firmware updates available or just a cumbersome process to update the firmware. And finally, a lot of teams seem to lose interest and you never really hear from the developers again. I'm really hoping that Ed and Joshua can continue to work on the project going forward and add support for even more cards to the A2 FPGA. It's actually an open source project, and I'll have a link in the show notes for where you can go. And so if you actually know how to do FPGA programming or you want to learn, I'm sure they would welcome any contributions to the project. The card itself costs $199 retail, which, although it sounds a little bit steep, is actually, I think, a pretty fair price. The VidHD card was somewhere around $150, I want to say, and then a new Mockingboard card would run you at least $100 or $150. So if you think that the A2 FPGA can do what both of those cards do, as well as possibly other cards in the future, I think it's well worth the price. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out and leave a comment below. And if I don't know the answer, I'll try to contact Ed or Joshua to get the answer to any questions. If you haven't subscribed to my channel, please hit the subscribe button. I'm really hoping to get enough subscribers that I'll be able to turn off advertising on my channel. So that's the goal. Also, I have a Patreon if you'd like to support me that way, and I'll have a link in the show notes to that. Once again, thanks for watching.